Welcome to LG Ministry. We're so thankful that you have joined us today. Today I'm going to begin a four-part series. The first two parts are going to be answering the question, are miracles here today? The third part is going to be about the providence of God. And then the fourth part is going to be about demons and whether or not demon possession is here today. So I hope you'll join us for this four-part series. When people think about the topic of demons, many things come to mind. They might ask, where did demons come from? What are their characteristics? And what was their purpose? And is there still demon possession today? These are excellent questions, and I will do my best to answer these questions from the Word of God. The first thing I want to do is to look at one definition of the word demon. Strong defines it this way: a spirit, a being inferior to God, superior to men, evil spirits or the messengers and ministers of the devil. With this in mind, let's now explore the origin of demons. First, I want to point out that there is only one devil, but there are many demons. I wish I could show you a specific passage that tells us who these demons are, but I cannot. This is one of these areas in the Bible that is not answered specifically. However, based on several scriptures, we can make an educated guess and narrow it down to two possibilities. Number one, some believe that these demons are those fallen angels described in the following passage, 2 Peter 2, verse number 4. For if God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment. Jude 1, verse 6. And the angels who did not keep their proper domain, but left their own abode, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of the great day. Now, there are at least four reasons this angel theory is possible. First, angels share a similar characteristic as demons in that they are both spirits. Hebrews 1, verse 14. Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for those who will inherit salvation? Second, our verse shows that angels have a free will and can be good or evil. Therefore, it's possible that God let them out of their confinement temporarily during the first century. The third reason comes from the fact that the devil and his angels were cast out of heaven. Revelation 12, verse 9. So the great dragon was cast out, the serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceived the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. See also Matthew 25, verse 41. Since these angels are associated with him, it makes sense that they are the demons we read about in the New Testament. The fourth reason comes from the fact that these demons knew who Jesus was and understood that he had power over them. Again, this would fit with an angel. Our second possibility is that these demons are those who have died and are classified as the wicked dead. Once we die, we are no longer in bodily form. Instead, we are in spiritual form, which is again one of the characteristics of a demon. It's possible that God could have allowed those wicked souls of Hades to be emptied out during the first century temporarily. From a historical point of view, both the Greeks and the Jews thought that demons were spirits from those who were sinners that had died. In fact, the Greek word used for demon, as used in the first century and in other books, was used to describe the departed spirit of a wicked person, which is what makes this a viable option as well. However, for either one of these views to work, it would require God to allow these angels of the devil to be released temporarily from their eternal chains. The same would be true for these wicked dead, because they would have to be let out of Hades, which they would not usually be allowed to leave from. So I guess a third possibility would be some spirits that the Bible just doesn't tell us about. Now, while we may not know exactly the origin of some of these demons that we read about in the New Testament, One thing we do know is that they were servants of the devil, and they were no match for God. Now let's take a look at their characteristics. As I mentioned, these demons were spirit beings, and we can see this in Matthew 8 and verse 16. When evening had come, they brought to him many who were demon-possessed, and he cast out the spirits with the word and healed all who were sick. Notice how demons and spirits are used interchangeably. Now notice what Jesus says about spirits in Luke 24 and verse 39. Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have. From this, we can see that demons are spiritual in nature and do not have physical bodies. We also learn that during the first century, they had the ability to possess someone and take them over. And more than one could enter a person's body. Luke 8, verse 2. And certain women who had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary called Magdalene, out of whom had come seven demons. So Mary had seven demons. Another thing we can learn about demons is that they were rational beings. We can see this in the following example, Mark 5, verse 1. Then they came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gadarenes. And when he had come out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no one could bind him, not even with chains, because he had often been bound with shackles and chains. And the chains had been pulled apart by him, and the shackles broken in pieces. Neither could anyone tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying out and cutting himself with stones. When he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and worshipped him. And he cried out with a loud voice, saying, What have I to do with you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I implore you by God that you do not torment me. For he said to him, Come out of the man, unclean spirit. Then he asked him, What is your name? And he answered, saying, My name is Legion, for we are many. Also he begged him earnestly that he would not send them out of the country. Now a large herd of swine was feeding there near the mountains. So all the demons begged him, saying, Send us to the swine that we may enter them. And at once Jesus gave them permission. Then the unclean spirits went out and entered the swine. There were about 2,000. And the herd ran violently down the steep place into the sea and drowned in the sea. See also Matthew 8, verse 28 through 34, and Luke 8, verses 26 through 39. Now both Mark and Luke focus on one man. However, Matthew informs us that there were two men that were possessed. Now we can learn a great deal about a demon's characteristic from these verses. One thing we learn is that once they are in the body, they are able to give it superhuman strength. We see this from the fact that no one could keep this man bound, and he even had the strength to tear apart the shackles they tried to keep him in. We also learn that demons had control over this man. Notice he didn't wear any clothes. He isolated himself in the tombs, and he cried out and cut himself with stones day and night, which means that he possibly never ever slept. As you look at other accounts, these demons always seem to want to harm their host, like the boy in Mark chapter 9, where the demon caused the boy to fall down in fire and water and caused him to foam at the mouth, gnash his teeth, and he made his body as stiff as a board. We also learn that demons recognized Jesus' authority and knew he was the Son of God. We can see this by how these demons worshiped Jesus and begged him not to torment them. In Luke's account, the demons begged Jesus not to send them to the abyss, which shows us two things. Number one, Jesus had the power over these demons. And number two, these demons could experience the emotion of fear, which is further emphasized in James 2 and verse 19. You believe that there is one God. You do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. The word tremble carries the idea of being struck with extreme fear or to be horrified. And no doubt these demons should be scared, as they will face torment day and night in hell. They also seemed to know that their time was limited. Another characteristic about demons is found in Matthew 12 in verse 43. When an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places, seeking rest, and finds none. Then he says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when he comes, he finds it empty, swept, and put in order. Then he goes and takes with him seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first. So shall it be also with this wicked generation. These verses teach us that demons can leave their host and then come back again. Also, they can communicate with other demons and get them to come along with them to reinvade that host. Some of these evil spirits were more wicked than the others. One last characteristic I want to look at is somewhat of a humorous one. When Paul was at Ephesus, it says that he worked unusual miracles in Acts 19, verse 11. Well, seven supposed Jewish exorcists heard about how Paul could cast out demons using Jesus' name. So they decided they would give it a try. But notice what happens when they do. Acts 19, verse 15. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you? Then the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them, overpowered them, and prevailed against them, so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded. And so here we can see, once again, demons given this man supernatural strength so that he could be able to take these seven men, beat them all up, and take off their clothes. These Jewish exorcists were using the right name, but they were not Christians. So this is why we can see this demon causing this one man to be able to beat them up and strip them of their clothes. Again, we see demons causing a person to have superhuman strength. Now that we have examined their characteristics, let's take a look at the question, what was their purpose? Why were these demons allowed to possess people? Again, this is another question that I cannot direct you to a specific scripture that states their purpose with clarity. However, I believe that we can surmise what their purpose was. The first thing I want to point out is that demon possession can only be seen in the New Testament, and this is very significant in answering our question. Now, I will say this, there is only two places in the Old Testament that even remotely sounds like demon possession, and our first one has to do with King Saul. 1 Samuel 16, verse number 14. But the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and a distressing spirit from the Lord troubled him. And Saul's servant said to him, Surely a distressing spirit from God is troubling you. Let our master now command your servants, who are before you, to seek out a man who is a skillful player on the harp. And it shall be that he will play it with his hand when the distressing spirit from God is upon you, and you shall be well. Now, when you think about these verses, they don't sound anything like demon possession. All it took was David playing his harp to make him feel better. But in the New Testament, it usually took miraculous powers to cast them out. However, Jesus does mention this one particular kind of demon that took prayer and fasting, which means that not all demons are exactly alike. Mark 9, verse number 29. As one commentator said regarding Saul, the evil spirit which afflicted Saul was not a living demon sent by God, but rather a sinister attitude brought on by his rejection of God. The second account is found in just a few verses and is rarely talked about in commentaries. 2 Chronicles 18, verse 19. And the Lord said, Who will persuade Ahab, king of Israel, to go up, that he may fail at Ramoth-Gilead? So one spoke in this manner, and another spoke in that manner. Then a spirit came forward and stood before the Lord and said, I will persuade him. The Lord said to him, In what way? So he said, I will go out and be a lying spirit in the mouth of all his prophets. And the Lord said, You shall persuade him and also prevail. Go out and do this. Therefore, look, the Lord has put a lying spirit in the mouth of these prophets of yours, and the Lord has declared disaster against you. This is a vague text that is quite interesting, Before we scratch our head too much about this particular section of Scripture, we need to understand that Ahab had been disobedient to God, and now God is going to make sure that Ahab will fall. We have this lying spirit who volunteers to basically give false prophecy to Ahab's prophets. Some think that this spirit may have been the devil himself, because he was used to test Job, so it would not be out of the realm of possibility here. Also, this would go along with how God will allow an evil army to come against his people when they are being disobedient. So he could also allow this lying spirit to carry out his task as well. It's not that God approved of lying here, but simply allowed the spirit to carry out his task. However, nothing in this vague text indicates that the spirit possessed anyone, but it says that he would persuade him. So with this in mind, I'm confident that demon possession only happened in the New Testament. And I believe this is important when we consider what Jesus says in 1 John 3 and verse number 8. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. We also know that Jesus said he came to seek and save the lost. But in order for him to do that, he had to destroy the works of the devil. This is also taught in Hebrews 2 and verse 14. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. By destroying the works of the devil, Jesus would prove that he was the Son of God. John 5, verse 36. But I have a greater witness than John's, for the works which the Father has given me to finish, the very works that I do, bear witness of me that the Father has sent me. Since Jesus was establishing his authority, he would not want to leave any rock unturned. So we see him demonstrating his authority in several ways. Number one, he healed diseases and physical deformities, Matthew 9, verse 20 through 22, John 4, verses 46 through 54. Number two, he calmed a storm, showing his control over nature, Matthew 8, verses 23 through 37. Number three, he had the power to multiply food, Matthew 14, verses 15 through 21. Number four, he had power over gravity as he walked across the water, Matthew 14, verse 22 through 23. Number five, he had power over death as he raised some from the dead, Matthew 9, verses 18 through 26, John chapter 11. Not only did Jesus show his authority over these things, he also showed his authority over the devil because he had the power to cast out these demons. It makes logical sense to me that the purpose of these demons was to show that Jesus had power over the spiritual world as well, which further confirms that he was the Son of God. Since one of Jesus' purpose for coming to the earth was to destroy the devil and his works, it makes perfect sense why we do not read about demons until the first century. These demons continued to exist for a short time after Jesus' death so that the apostles or whoever was revealing God's word could prove that what they were speaking was coming from God by working miracles and casting out demons. Again, we can see this in Mark 16, starting in verse 17. And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. So then, after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and preached everywhere, the Lord working through them and confirming the word through accompanying signs. Amen. Just as we examined in 1 Corinthians 13, verses 8 and 10 in an earlier lesson, once the word of God was fully revealed, there would be no more purpose for miracles, so they would cease. Well, in the same way, there would be no more reason for demon possession to occur. Since it took miraculous powers for the most part to cast out demons, it certainly wouldn't make sense for God to allow demon possession to continue with no way for Christians to expel them. Which brings us to our final question, which I've already answered in part. Is demon possession here today? Some may think this is a silly question, but I can promise you that there are some who teach that demon possession is alive and well today. In fact, I've even heard of a Church of Christ preacher proclaim this very thing. Now, I'm not trying to make fun of those who teach this, but it always cracks me up because they always seem to say that, yeah, demon possession happens, but it's over in third world countries. It's like that demons are afraid of modern society, so they only hang out at places like Africa. Do you see the humor in that? When you think about this, if you go over to Africa and you hear about their culture, they believe in voodoo. They believe in all kinds of magic and things like that. So they have the mindset. They're already ready to think that things that are happening are associated with something magical or possibly with demons. But that simply is not the case. Let me give you some common sense reasons of why demon possession is not here today. Number one, as I've already mentioned, it wouldn't make much sense for God to end miracles and leave us stuck with demons with no way of getting rid of them. Number two, I want you to think about the characteristics that demons had and compare that to the supposed demon possessed of today. I can guarantee you that they will not compare. For example, when have you heard of someone having superhuman strength and not being able to be bound? You haven't, because demon possession is not here today. When we honestly compare today's supposed demon possessions with what we read about in the New Testament, we can clearly see that they don't match up. Number three, I want you to think about the following passage, 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13. No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you're able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. We need to remember that demons have the ability to take over a person and to cause them to do things they normally would not do. Well, according to what Paul is teaching us, we have a free will. And when we do something wrong, it's of our own doing. The temptations that we experience are common to man. This means we cannot say the devil made me do it. If demon possession is alive and well, it would mean that they could overtake our free will, and this goes beyond the realm of what is common to man. Finally, I want you to look at a prophecy that shows that both miracles and demon possession would come to an end at the spreading of the gospel. Zechariah 13, verse number 1. In that day, a fountain shall be opened for the house of David and for the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and for uncleanness. It shall be in that day, says the Lord of hosts, that I will cut off the names of the idols from the land, and they shall no longer be remembered. I will also cause the prophets and the unclean spirits to depart from the land. It shall come to pass that if anyone still prophesies, then his father and mother who begot him will say to him, you shall not live because you have spoken lies in the name of the Lord. And his father and mother who begot him shall thrust him through when he prophesies. And it shall be in that day that every prophet will be ashamed of his vision when he prophesies. They will not wear a robe of coarse hair to deceive, but he will say, I am no prophet, I am a farmer, for a man taught me to keep cattle from my youth. Zechariah is foretelling the time when Jesus would be here, and he points out the blessings that would occur from the spreading of God's word. Verse 2 indicates that there will be no more prophecies and that the unclean spirits will depart from the land. I believe this is pointing to 1 Corinthians 13, verses 8 through 10, which I've already shown in a previous lesson that the miracles would cease once the word of God was fully revealed. Once God's word was fully revealed, there would be no more prophets because there would be no more prophecies. Daniel 9 and verse 24 also talks about how visions and prophecies would be sealed up during this time. So from Zechariah's prophecy, we can conclude that when the prophecies or miracles ended, so did demonic possession. One of the main reasons I think it's sad that people believe in demonic possession today is because it gives people a fear that they should not have. In conclusion, Hope I've shed some light on the topic of demons. We examined their origin, their characteristic, and their purpose. Hope I've shown you without a doubt that demon possession was only in the first century and does not exist today. And I hope you will share this information with those who might be confused on this topic. I hope you found today's lesson helpful. No matter what lesson I preach, I want you to test what I say or any person says about God's Word by comparing what is being said to what the Scriptures actually say. Don't ever be lazy in this area because it's too important to simply trust in what man is saying because we are all human and we're capable of being wrong. One thing we know for sure is that God's Word will not lead us astray. So always trust in it. As Psalm 146:3 says, "Do not put your trust in princes, nor in a son of man, in whom there is no help." Psalm 18, verse 30, "As for God, His way is perfect. The word of the Lord is proven. He is a shield to all who trust in Him." I will always do my best to preach the truth, but I hope if you catch me teaching error that you will contact me so that we can discuss the matter. If you would like to learn more about LG Ministry and the congregation I preach at, feel free to visit our website at lgchurchofchrist.com. On our website, you will find a lot of material that can help you with your spiritual growth. On our main page, you will find an online correspondence course you can take that will walk you through the basics. On our sermon page, you will find just about every sermon I have preached at my local congregation. You will also find some audio sermons and Bible class materials that you are free to study and use. On our article page, you will find tracts that you can read and print off and articles that have been written for our local paper. Finally, on our video page, you will find all the new video lessons that I have made, including the one that you're watching right now. I know that we live in a fast-paced world where it seems like we don't have the time to do much of anything. But I want to encourage you to find time out of each day to sit down and to study God's Word. Life is great, and there's nothing wrong with being busy. But we must be careful that we don't become so busy that we fail to take time to feed ourselves spiritually from God's Word. We must remember that God is supposed to be our number one priority in life. If you find my lessons to be helpful, be sure and tell people about our program so that others can hear sound lessons from the Bible. I hope you have a blessed day.